Okay, well, if you would turn with me in your Bibles to Leviticus chapter 20. Yay! And here we are tonight once again in the book of Leviticus, the interesting book of Leviticus. The interesting, but you know what? Necessary. It's a necessary book. It's a necessary thing for us to know what God perceives holiness as. And I don't want to start talking about that because I'm going to talk about it again in a minute. But it is. It's just a necessary thing. And I'm thankful tonight for God's word in my life. I'm thankful tonight that he hasn't left us alone. I'm thankful tonight that he gives us those guardrails and that guideline in life called the word of God that we get to walk by. So that we are able to have corner edge shaved beards, one of the benefits. Okay, that's from last week. But you know what, before we start, I just wanted to give a plug really quick. Personally, I'm really excited for Harvest America. And that's just me personally. I'm excited to go, and I would just encourage you, if you have any desire at all, or even think you're like on the edge, I would encourage you to pray over if God wants you to go down there and serve. Because to me, there's nothing like being a part of something that's so much bigger than you are. And it's in the name of God. It's just going to be an awesome thing. And then, of course, to see hordes of people coming down to accept Christ, that's going to be an overwhelming thing. It's going to be awesome, too. So personally, if at all possible, I'm on the list, I think. Am I on the list? My wife put me on the list. I have no choice. I'm going to Phoenix in the middle of summer, but it's going to be great. It's going to be great. It's a dry heat. That's right. It's like a barbecue grill. It's a dry heat. Okay, so anyways, there's my plug for that. If you need, you can always come to the office or talk to me if you want one of those bumper stickers. I have one, and I still haven't put it on. I got rebuked the other day by a certain person that I won't mention any names, but I didn't put mine on yet. So I'm going to do that very quickly, very shortly. So we're going to Leviticus chapter 20. And just to set the stage for what we're going through this evening, over the last 2 weeks, we've gone through chapters 18 and chapter 19. You guys are good with math. I like that. So chapter 18 we looked at, which covered really the whole of chapter 18 covered God's law in regards to sexual conduct for the people of God. And most of it was in regards to what not to do, sexual immorality, which the biggest section of chapter 18 had really to do with incest. Okay. And we looked at why it had to do, why the biggest section of the not to do's of chapter 18 had to do with incest. We looked at why. It's the biggest section in that chapter of 18, and the first reason is because, number one, God instituted marriage. In the beginning, God made them male and female. He instituted the first marriage, and Jesus referred to that as to what marriage is supposed to look like. It's supposed to look like what God started out with. That's what it's supposed to look like. So that's the first reason. The second reason is because God, through the institution of marriage, instituted the family, instituted the home. And so especially sexually speaking, the marriage bed and the family and the home are supposed to remain undefiled and the safest place for your children and the safest place for them to learn about what God thinks about sex. And what does God think about sex? It's beautiful, and he designed it for where he designed it, in the confines of a marriage. One man, one woman in marriage. So really, I guess all this to say, the Christian home should be the best place to learn of these things, should be the safest place. It's a place where, and I've gone through a little episode with my son, who is going to be 13 very shortly. According to him, he's growing a mustache. I know some of you are shaking your head and you're thinking, no, 13, he was just that big, right? I know I was thinking the same thing. But he's growing a mustache, according to himself. He's chopped wood. He's rode a mechanical bull. He's a man. So I have got to talk to him, and I've been having these conversations that are difficult, but I'm so open that he's going like, oh, and I'm like, do you understand? Oh, don't talk to me about that. But I don't want him to learn it from Google, and I don't want him to learn it from some other kids. I want him to learn what God has to say, because it's a beautiful thing in marriage. So here I am, and I'm trying to, you know, for a while there I thought it's too early, but then like we went through this little incident, and it's not too early. It's definitely not too early, because he's got questions. And so even though it might shame him or blush him to death, I give him the answers. And I tell him, if you want to know what that stuff's about, talk to me. So, and it should be. It should be that way. Okay. So, also, besides the laws on incest, we have these miscellaneous laws that still had to do with sexual immorality. If you remember back to verse 21, it was the passing on of a newborn through the fire of Molech. So, really, it was the killing of an infant. I mean, that's really what it was. It was the killing of an infant in demonic worship. So he showed that there's a couple of other miscellaneous ones that, like, a man is not supposed to lie with a man as a woman and vice versa. So we got some of these things. And the reason I'm kind of touching on these is because we're going to go over some of these in the chapter tonight. And then if you remember in chapter 19 from last week, chapter 19 dealt with a few different things. It was more like just the common laws of life, and how the children of Israel were to conduct themselves in relations with one another, just, you know, some of the normal life stuff, and then some of the more interesting ones. But it dealt with, first of all, honoring your father and mother. It dealt with remembering the Sabbath day, the day that we saw was set aside for worship. So right off the bat, first two, family and worship of God. Taking a day to go and take your family, lead them in the ways of God. Then it went to taking care of the poor. It went to being just and righteous in our dealings with people. And then some of the things that it went to really weren't sinful, or at least they weren't an obvious sinful thing, like mixing of different kinds of seeds in your field. Something that God said, don't do that. So for us, we're going like, what? I don't understand. But it was one of those things that God is trying to protect them, and he wants them to be, in this theme of chapter, in this chapter, in this section in the book, the theme of holiness, he wants their fields even to look different than the fields of the world. And I like that. So we looked at last week, God might be asking you to do something, and it's not like you're trying to cut out a sin, it's just a thing. Are you going to do it? We should do it. And then he went on to, and he covered the mourning for the dead, that we're supposed to look different in our mourning for the dead, and we're going to get to that, probably not tonight, maybe next week, with, Mike, are you teaching next week?
I think so.
Oh, man, you better straighten that out, bro. Okay. Okay. So then he went with, I don't know why that came out, but oh, because we're going to cover that next week. But mourning for the dead, which covered the beard trimming, the shaving the sides of your head, the cutting yourself, and tattoos. Yes, somebody moaned over the tattoos. Okay. And I'm not going to talk about tattoos. You got go look at the video from last week. And also he talked about soothsaying and astrology and seances and the children of Israel were not to do any of these things really that were common among the world. So that really leads us to the main point of this whole section, and it's that the children of Israel were not to do the things that the world around them was doing. They were to be holy because why? Because God is holy. And I love that. So in regards to sex, and in regards to the treatment of the poor, in regards to the spiritual life, or what not to do in the occult, in regards to death, in regards to the normal human conduct with each other, the people of God should look different than the people of the world. Why? Because we have God. We have a relationship with God, and the world doesn't. We have a hope. We have a joy. I don't know if any of you here have accepted Jesus, but if you have, your sins are forgiven.
Yeah.
I mean, that's huge. God has every reason to look at me and smite me, but my sins are washed white. I have a lot of reason to be joyful, to be happy, because God is amazing. So because of the seriousness, though, of sin and the seriousness of what sin will do in your life, anybody in here can testify, or can anyone in here testify and say, sin messes up my life? Yes, right? Uh-huh. So this is because of the seriousness of sin and what sin does and what it will do to a people, a family, a home, a marriage, and a nation, God gives us chapter 20. And he goes into, and really, it's not just to us. We're going to try to glean from it. But really, it's to the nation of Israel. It's to his own nation, of his people. And you know, when I hear that, I go, I want to be his people. I want to be called by his name. But there is a context of it's going to be to his nation of Israel. And I'm not an Israelite. I am not a Jewish person. I said that funny. One time, we had some people that were new to the church, and they visited for like one day, and they came up to me, and my hair was like longer and shaggier. My beard was shorter. It was a different time in life, but he came up to me, and this lady came up to me and goes, are you Jewish? And I'm like, no, but I wish I was. So anyways, sometimes people might think you're Jewish, but you're not. Unless you are. Are you? Okay, anyways. I'm sorry. So, Lord, help us. Leviticus chapter 20. So here he goes on to Leviticus chapter 20. Because of sin, because of what sin does, he goes into these judgments or these consequences for committing these sins and going directly against the word of God. So chapter 20, verse 1. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, again, you shall say to the children of Israel, whoever of the children of Israel or of the strangers who dwell in Israel who gives any of his descendants to Molech, he shall surely be put to death. The people of the land shall stone him with stones. I will set my face against that man, and I will cut him off from his people because he has given some of his descendants to Molech to defile my sanctuary and to profane my holy name. You guys remember what profane means? It's going to be in here throughout some of this, but to profane means to make common, right? To make common. And this word almost has the idea of undoing something. So something that God has set and said, this is holy, we would take to profane it would be to just undo it and kind of say, well, that's just, well, you know, well, I know God says that, but to undo, to profane, to make it common, something we don't want to do. So the first one that we see here, this first law that we see here, to me is one that's an easy one. And by an easy one, I mean it's one that I agree with. If somebody's going to put their infant on the red-hot sizzling arms of an idol to kill it, I would say God is totally just in killing them and taking their life. Great. I agree 100%. It's an easy one to agree with. But as we go through some of these judgments, there's going to be some that I think are going to be difficult for us and maybe kind of a hard one to swallow because of the difference in culture. And one of the biggest reasons and biggest differences is because the nation of Israel is a nation at this point in history, and for a while it's going to be, that is a theocracy, which means it's governed directly by God, right? So we're not a theocracy. Our nation is governed by Donald Trump. No. But it's not, and I'm sorry, I didn't really want to say man's name, but it's man. Our nation is governed by a man. And it's governed by really what man thinks is best. And we got a judicial system, and we got the systems that legislate all these things. So we got man in charge of this. And of course, when the men are trying to follow God and trying to follow God's word, like the case in the beginning of our nation, things went pretty good. Things go okay. We still have man, so there's still problems, but when they're trying to follow God, they seem to be okay. But when men begin to do whatever they feel is right, apart from the word of God, then we have problems. We begin to have problems and more problems. And of course, I think of the legislation of sin that's been happening recently in our recent past. And those things, I think, man, there's going to be problems. I mean, natural problems, there's going to be supernatural problems. But anyways, the bottom line is, no matter how good these men's intentions are, if it goes against the word of God, it's not going to have a good outcome. So anyways, in my opinion, this one about Molech and killing somebody for killing their babies on it, it's, to me, it's a no-brainer. So the person who worships Molech by sacrificing an infant shall be stoned. It's a capital punishment for a capital crime. So they're to be stoned. And you guys probably know what being stoned is. Of course, it's coming. It's not with marijuana. It's being stoned with stones that were, you know, like river rocks, basically. And it was not a pretty thing. They'd throw a pile of rocks on a person until they died from it. So when I think of this, when I think of this punishment of somebody killing an infant, I think in our culture agrees and our culture also disagrees. Because if you think about the laws, if there was an inebriated driver who wrecks into a car with a pregnant mom and kills the mother and the baby, that person, that man, is charged with two counts of manslaughter. But if, for the sake of inconvenience or hardship, the mother decides she wants to terminate the unborn child, that's okay. And sad to say, that's more like what offering newborns to Molech was about. It was about not regarding this newborn as an authentic life or valuable, and also terminating for self, but for my comfort, for my rights, for my convenience. And also, like I mentioned before, I believe the same darkness, the same exact principalities and powers that were behind Molech are the same ones that are behind this world voice that's saying, it's okay, you have your rights. You have your rights to take the life. And you know what's funny is the argument, I've heard some of the arguments back and forth on Facebook, they really make me sad. They really break my heart. As people want to say, well, it's not really a human. And you say, well, what defines a human? And they'll say, well, they have to be able to support themselves and live on their own. And I thought, well, if my wife, for some reason, is gone from my life, I will not be a human. I will not be able to fend for myself. I'll go and tell my children, where does the clean underwear come from? And they'll say, I don't know. No, but seriously though, you know, my 2-year-old, my almost to be 3-year-old, she couldn't fend for herself in this life. Is she a human? Obviously she's a human. And I started talking to my wife, I started looking up some statistics, and at 5 weeks, a baby in the womb has its own blood, the muscles are developed, they have their own antibodies that'll fight sickness. And so I'm thinking about 5 weeks. So I text my wife, when did you know, when did we find out that you were pregnant? She said 5 weeks. I'm like, that is crazy. So about the time that you would find out that you're even pregnant and this little thing is in you, it's a human. God has already done so many miracles. to form this child. And if you haven't seen the movie, that one, Fearfully and Wonderfully Made, I would say watch it. It is so amazing what happens. I mean, I did a whole section back, I think, in Genesis when I was talking about human and how amazing the body is. And I remember talking about how many, I can't remember, I want to say every, you can't quote me on this, but you can look it up. But every, I want to say like 10 seconds, there was 3 million heart cells being formed. Every 10 seconds. And I'm going, this is a miracle. And of course, watch the movie. It's an absolute miracle. So the voices that are saying it's not a human, they're voices that have been around for a long time. And they're going completely against the word of God. So, then in verse 3, we look back to verse 3. Let's look at it. I'm going to read it again. Verse 3 says, I will set my face against that man and will cut him off from his people because he has given some of his descendants to Molech to defile my sanctuary and profane or make common my name. So really there's one of two ways to take this. Number one is it's simply commenting on verse 2 and saying that describing that this type of cutting off is death by stoning, which makes a whole lot of sense, or it's saying that the person that sacrifices their infant and doesn't get stoned because they don't get caught, basically, they get away with it, that in that case, God is still going to judge that person and set his face against them. So you're not going to get away with it. And it's like God is saying, even if you think you're getting away with it, you're really not, because I see, and I'll set my face against you. Personally, that's scary. Just saying. And that touches me as well. And for any sin in my life or in our life that we think we're getting away with, you're not. We're not. God sees. And he'll set his face against it. Because when you think you're getting away with it, really what you're doing and what I'm doing, we're hurting ourselves and we're distancing ourselves from God, from God's people and the truth. So then he goes on in verse 4 to finish the section on Molech here, and he says, and if the people of the land should in any way hide their eyes from the man when he gives some of his descendants to Molech, and they do not kill him, then I will set my face against that man, against his family, and I will cut him off from his people and all who prostitute themselves with him to commit harlotry with Molech. So God says in verse 5, he'll set his face against anyone who knows and doesn't do anything about it, who stays silent. And God's saying, if you don't take a stand against this darkness, I will set my face against you. And again, in this context, he's speaking directly to the children of Israel, but I think also he's speaking to us, because what comes to my mind for the Christian, for us in our day and age, is if we don't take a stand for righteousness, who's going to take a stand? Whatever's convenient, whatever's easiest. It doesn't matter if it's biblical or godly, that's the way we should do it. I mean, that's the voice that comes out. And I just pray that somewhere there's someone that'll stand up and say, no. No, God, obviously by this section, innocent life is important to God. And there is no more innocent than a baby in the womb. Amen? So God, I mean, he's not messing around. He's not messing around. Verse 6. And the person who turns to mediums and familiar spirits to prostitute himself with them, I will set my face against that person and cut him off from his people. So, obviously, the person that's involved in the occult is condemned to this banishment, or, again, that's one of those ones, I'll set my face against that person. It could mean banishment or it could mean death personally within the context of where it's at. And this big old list at the top of this chapter that's talking about death, I would say he's talking about killing, stoning them, capital punishment. Verse 7, he says, "Consecrate yourself, therefore, and be holy, for I am the Lord your God. And you shall keep my statutes and perform them. I am the Lord who sanctifies you." Now, in my Bible, at the verse 7 is at the end of a section, and verse 8 is kind of the beginning of a new one, but they go together, they complement each other so well. They're amazing, and it's kind of this plead from God between these verses as he takes these two verses and reminds us of the theme again. It's being holy, for he is holy, for he is God. And it's to keep his statutes and perform them because it is he who sanctifies you. And I have to pause there for just a moment and note how there's instruction for us to keep his statutes, to perform them. There's instruction for us to do something. There's responsibility for us. And there's instruction that it's God who sanctifies us. So when I read this, I look at it, I say, God has no problem saying, you have responsibility and I'm sovereign. Right there in the same breath. You have responsibility, but I'm sovereign. I'm the one who sanctifies you. He has no problem saying, I'm the Lord, keep my statutes, I'm giving you these rules, I'm giving you these laws to do them. And he has no problem saying, I am the Lord who sanctifies you. So according to this text, and according to what he says right there, do your work sanctify you? No, he says, I am the Lord who sanctifies you. He sanctifies us. Now, having said all that, let me just take a minute here and kind of pick this apart a minute. Because practically in life, in reality, our works, the things that we do, the actions that we do, especially in keeping with God's word, they do sanctify us. They do set us apart. You might be thinking, what? But I thought you just said God sanctifies us. He does, but our following his word practically in this life sets us apart. It makes us look different from the rest of the world, right? I mean, you start doing these things, and people are going to look at you and go, what kind of weird cult are you following? And you're going to say, it's just Jesus. I'm following God. That's it. And they're going to say, you go to church too much. And you're going to say, I feel like I can't get to church enough because I want to hear what God has to say in my life. But it makes us different. It changes us. So practically, the works do set us apart from the rest of the world. But positionally or eternally, only the sacrifice of Jesus Christ sanctifies us before God. Does that make sense? You get where I'm coming from? So there are two washings that have to happen. One is the washing in the water of the word that separates us here on this earth, changes our actions. And the second is the washing in the blood that makes us white before God, that sanctifies us in eternity. So here are the two truths, these two things. Number one is that we need both of those. And number two is that without God, we have neither. We don't have his word. We don't have his instruction if we don't have him. And we don't have the blood of Christ. So we need him. And when I think of that, the sum of the whole thing is truly it is God who sanctifies us. It's God who sets us apart. Thank you, Lord. Because if we don't have him in our lives, especially if we don't have Jesus and his sacrifice, we're not sanctified. Okay, moving on. Verse 9. The next penalty is, for everyone who curses his father and mother shall be put to death. He has cursed his father or his mother. His blood shall be upon him. Now, personally, if you're a parent, your flesh probably goes, I like this one. You curse at me, you're dead. You look at me wrong, you're dead. I mean, it's just one of those things where your flesh goes, ooh, cool. But that's not the case. Okay, let me talk about it for a second. Most schools of thought say this isn't referring to like an 8-year-old with an outburst of wrath that yells, I hate you, and storms off to his room or her room. Because of the law, and because of this verse, though, I guarantee that happened a whole lot less. But rather, what it's referring to is a young adult, somebody who is past their bar mitzvah age, the age of accountability. So that's around 12, 13, 14 years old. And in that culture, they have the responsibilities of an adult. And they're not just a mad, frustrated teenager who's having problems with hormones and stuff. That's not really what it's talking about. But really, it's talking about a young adult, a young teen that has turned completely against their parents and has a heart attitude of cursing their parents. It's an attitude, it's a heart of rebellion. It's an attitude that says, no, I hate you, I will not, and it's living in that place. And so many times, though, in our culture, when somebody reads this verse, they instantly think the Bible is horrible. God is cruel. He says, you know, if you have a day when your kid's having a bad day, the Bible says you can take them out in the back and kill them. And that's just not the case. It really is not the case. And so I'm going to just kind of refer to a couple of different verses. But in Deuteronomy chapter 21, there's a section in there, verses 18 through 21, that really clears up the thought that says that if a parent's having a bad day and their kid talks back, they can take them out back and stone them to death. Because what it says, what it reveals to us there in that section is that this child had to be taken to the council and judged. So it was out of the hands of the parents. They actually had to basically take their kid to court to do this. And I don't know, between you and me, that would be a really hard thing to do. I mean, there's not parents lining up to say, I want mine killed. That's just really not how it happens. It's not human nature. It's not God's nature. This is an extreme case. So they have to be taken to this council, they have to be judged, and it kind of describes in two places there, in verse 18 and in verse 21 of Deuteronomy 21. And it says this, this son of ours is stubborn, he's rebellious, he will not obey our voice, he's a glutton and a drunkard. So it's showing this guy's whole life is an attitude against God, against godliness, against honoring the parents. So it's a little more than talking back. It had to do with a child living in a state of continued rebellion and defiance. And then, of course, there's a whole difference in the culture where the kids were connected to the parents for basically life. And if the kids made a big mistake, guess what? Guess who pays for it? If the kids can't, the parents pay for it. You know, nowadays you're like, he's 18, take him to court. I'm not paying, you know. There's a whole different kind of mentality. But you think about that and you go, man, if that was the case throughout life, you'd be trying to raise your parents. I mean, your kids. You could try to raise your parents. It doesn't work very good. You try to raise your kids the best you can because it matters, and we should. You guys, that's one of the differences that should be in our lives. We should be trying to raise our kids the best way we can. You know, and sometimes I sit at home and think, Lord, I need your help. I need more of your grace in my life. I need more of you in my life when it comes to raising my kids. I want to be a better parent. Then in verse 10, he moves on to the rule for someone committing adultery. The man who commits adultery with another man's wife, he who commits adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer, the adulteress, shall surely be put to death. Hey, I pushed a button and it did something. Sorry. I was trying to get the second slide with the gavel on it. Yay! So, the penalty for committing adultery? Death. Again, you think, man, that is so harsh. But really, one of the commentaries said, it is dealing with something that can very rapidly take over a culture, and that is sexual sin. In Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 6 through 7, it's another one that sheds light on this. They couldn't just kill somebody right there. If somebody did something deserving of the death penalty, according to the law there in Deuteronomy 17, there had to be two or three witnesses, and then one of them had to be willing to initiate the stoning by casting the first stone. Ring a bell? Sound familiar? John chapter 10, I believe it was. It brings to light that situation in John where those religious rulers brought the woman who had been caught in the very act of adultery. And we see there that they really had no plan to uphold the law, or they would have brought the man. And let me just say, when you catch somebody in the act of adultery, there's two people. There's always two people. And so here's this problem here where you see really what they were doing. They were just trying to trap Jesus, and then it didn't work. But one commentary said, these death sentences were rarely carried out, but still, the thought of the consequences of them, if they were to be properly caught, the consequence was so costly, so steep, that it would change the outlook of somebody thinking about breaking the law. And it makes sense. It didn't happen all the time, but every once in a while, there's a death in the city. Why? These two guys were committing adultery, and God takes it serious, and people are going, what? Wow. I knew that was in there, I just had never seen it, and now there's two dead people. So anyways, we keep moving on through, and now the list turns really to chapter 18, and it goes through this whole list of sexual sins. So verse 11, the man who lies with his father's wife has uncovered his father's nakedness, both of them shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them. If a man lies with his daughter-in-law, both of them shall surely be put to death. They have committed perversion. They've perverted what God's designed, is the idea. Their blood shall be upon them. If a man lies with a male as he lies with a woman, both of them had committed an abomination. They shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them. And I want to just stop for one moment and make this point, because there's so many people that think that Christians are just straight up homophobic, you know, and they want to kill all of the homosexuals. That's not the case. Just like any sin, okay? So for the sin, the consequence for committing adultery, death. The consequence for homosexual sin, heterosexual, homosexual, and the next one is going to be bestiality. Any of these sins in this way, the consequence was the same. So God doesn't like play favorites. He doesn't say, get the homosexuals. He never does that. It is God's heart. It is God's intent that how many should perish. It doesn't say homosexuals or the worst sinners. It doesn't say anything like that. It is God's plan that none should perish. One of the commentaries put a note that I thought was interesting about homosexual sin. He said, you do not kill someone who has homosexual tendencies. You work with them. You work with the law. You work. What do? Well, first of all, you lead them to Christ. And if they're willing and they accept the Lord in their life, then like any other Christian, they begin to have a relationship with Jesus to where they love him more than the sin. I mean, it's just a normal thing. It's just the standard is set for everyone. There's no, you know, curve. There's no, none of that stuff. It's no graded on a curve. It's the same. Then he says in verse 14, if a man marries a woman and her mother, it is wickedness. They shall be burned with fire, both he and they, that there may be no wickedness among you. So this is an interesting one, because for some reason there's a different judge, a different judgment, a different consequence for the circumstance where a man basically uncovers, lies with, marries a woman and a mother. Or the other parallel to this in chapter 18, verse 17, is just flip-flopped. It's a daughter and a mother. If a man lays with these, and he says, here it is, all three of them are to be burned. Burned with fire. And why? Why do they have to be burned with fire? The explanation is at the end of 14. It says that there may be no wickedness among you. And basically he's saying here that for some reason in the heart of God, this is a horrible thing. It's called wickedness in both of those places. It's completely wicked. And God says, I don't want to see, I don't want there to be any wickedness among you. I want it to be done away with. All three of them burned. So there's a few different interpretations as to what being burned means, burned with fire means. The first one's the most obvious. Means there's some commentaries that say they think it meant to be burned alive. One of them was kind of weird and out there, and I don't know exactly where he would have pulled this from, but he said one of the things he looked up said that they would pour molten lead down their throat. That doesn't, I have no idea where that comes from. There's no inkling of that in the text. Yeah, it's a little rough. Being burned alive is rough anyways. It's a bad thing. But number two, and probably the most common through the commentaries that I went through, is that they would be stoned first and then their bodies would be burned so that, the end of verse 14, there would be no wickedness. There'd be no remnants of memory of that. It just would be completely gone. And so that's, but still, that's a heavy one. And then the third, another interesting, a couple of commentaries favored this explanation, that they would actually be branded with a red-hot iron on a place that was visible so they could be marked, so that people would see. And that's just like, it, I don't know. It's, that to me is pretty super harsh, and I'm just thankful in my own sinful life that God hasn't branded me with my sins on my face or something, right? Because if anyone knows the dirt on you, it's him, right? It's him. I'm so thankful for the forgiveness that we have. But still, there's just something to be said. This is a sinful thing, something that God detests. It's a wicked thing. Verse 15, and this is, again, one of those ones where you go, that's absolutely gross. If a man mates with an animal, he shall surely be put to death. You shall kill the and you shall kill the animal. If a woman approaches any animal and mates with it, you shall kill the woman and the animal, and they shall surely be put to death. So then verse 17 goes into a section with further immorality that may not have the death penalty. Seemingly it doesn't, but there's still bad things as a result. Verse 17, if a man takes his sister, his father's daughter, or his mother's daughter, and sees her nakedness, and she sees his nakedness, it is a wicked thing, and they shall be cut off in the sight of their people. He has uncovered his sister's nakedness, he shall bear his guilt. If a man lies with a woman during her sickness and uncovers her nakedness, he has exposed her flow, and she has uncovered the flow of her blood. Both of them shall be cut off from their people. Again, we're not sure if it's death or banishment. Either one's not good. But one commentary I liked, he said, look, the issue here isn't really the woman's time of the month and the blood that's going on. The issue is one of the heart. Just like with all of these sexual sins, it's the heart that says, I don't care what God says, I'm going to do what my flesh wants to do. And we looked at this a few weeks ago. The body is not for sin, but for the Lord. The body is not for sexual sin, but for the Lord. Paul said it really clearly. The body is for the Lord. Not to be, so basically your body makes a very poor master, but it makes a good servant if it's under submission to Jesus. Amen? So verse 19, you shall not uncover the nakedness of your mother's sister or of your father's sister, for that would uncover his near of kin, and they shall bear their guilt. If a man lies with his uncle's wife, he has uncovered his uncle's nakedness, they shall bear their sin, and they shall die childless. If a man takes his brother's wife, it is an unclean thing, and he has uncovered his brother's nakedness, they shall be childless. So we see a few different consequences here, some of bearing their guilt, some of being childless, which all of that stuff is up to God, what God's going to do in their life. It's not a man putting this punishment upon them. It's just God sees and God knows. And his heart, his desire isn't waiting to bust us, but his heart is for our well-being, for our goodness. His heart is that we would live a life that is more abundant than this world. So verse 22, he says, you shall therefore keep my statutes, and closing, you shall keep my statutes and all my judgments and perform them, that the land where I am bringing you to dwell may not vomit you out. Again, referring to that vomiting out, that the land of Canaan, where they're headed, God's going to use them to help the land vomit them out so that they would be out of there because their corruption is so great. Verse 23, and you shall not walk in the statutes of the nation which I am casting out before you, for they commit all these things, and therefore I abhor them. But I have said to you, you shall inherit their land, and I will give it to you to possess, a land flowing with milk and honey. Again, really that refers to, you know, cattle and goats. There's a land fertile for the livestock and honey, that there's pollination, there's flowers, there's wheat. There's going to be, you know, awesome fertile land to go to. And he says, I am the Lord your God who has separated you from the people. You shall therefore distinguish between clean animals and unclean, between unclean birds and clean. You shall not make yourselves abominable by beast or bird or any or by any kind of living thing that creeps on the ground, which I have separated from you as unclean. And verse 26, and you shall be holy to me, for I the Lord am holy, and have separated you from the people that you should be mine. And that last verse right there, the last section of 26, just grabs a hold of my heart personally. That God's heart is the same for you. I want you to be mine. You're mine. I mean, that sums up kind of that verse that talks about God being a jealous God. He's not jealous of your things or your house or any of that stuff. No, he's jealous when we turn our hearts toward ungodliness and when we begin to worship ourselves or worship money or whatever it may be and put those things in our life above him in our life. Because his desire is that we would be his, and I just love it. So again, we have these rules, these laws, even the consequences of sin are all because he loves us and he wants his best for us. And really, what this is, what this scripture is, what this book is for us, is it's a warning. It's a warning against things that will destroy your family and destroy your life and make allow you to be a mockery, if you will, of God. And it reminds me, man, just last Sunday with whoever has kids in here, I was with your kids and I was teaching them Genesis chapter 4. And we read this verse, Genesis chapter 4, verse 7. God's telling Cain, who killed Abel, he's saying, if you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door, and its desire is for you. But you should rule over it. Man, it's one of the most clearest passages that God is saying, you have a choice. Follow me. Follow my rule, and it'll be well with you. Follow my word. Because again, his heart is that how many should perish? None. Oh, I love his heart. I love John chapter 3, verse 15 and 16. It says that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God is good. His heart is for us, that we would be his. I think of that Song of Solomon verse that I am my beloved's and my beloved is mine. And that's God's heart toward us. Verse 27. Okay, and then we take the curveball in the corner pocket. Verse 27. And a man or a woman who is a medium or who has familiar spirits shall surely be put to death. They shall stone them with stones, and their blood shall be upon them. So again, we look at some of these and we think, man, that's harsh. Because these people, they're just people. But they're practicing divination. And God, when he gives us these rules, he, especially for the children of Israel, he has all people, all of his nation in mind. And not just in the here and now, not just in life, in this life, but more importantly, God has eternity in mind. And that's a big deal. God knows all too well that sin equals death. And when people are in a place of sick, gross, wicked, perverse darkness, so many times they want to bring people down with them. And it's really the grace and the goodness of God that says, I want to squash this sin, and I want it out of my land, and I want it out of my people for their protection. For their protection from sin and death. And I want to leave you with a couple of things. This first one, I want you to remember this. Sin is not bad because it's forbidden. Sin is forbidden because it's bad. It's forbidden because it's harmful and hurtful. Not because God doesn't want you to have fun. It's because God wants you to have a good life. And that really leads me to the next point that I want to make. And it's that we would teach our children, or we would teach those around us, to say no to sin. Not try it out or whatever feels good to you, but to say no to the things that God calls sin. And one commentary said it like this. If we could teach our kids, you can have a little bit of pleasure now by saying yes to sin and have a lifetime of pain. Or you can have a little bit of pain now by saying no to sin and a lifetime of God's pleasure and protection on your life. I know that's small and simple, but that's really where it's at. So I want to have Caleb come up. And let's all stand together and just pray. Just lift this time up to the Lord. God, I want to thank you tonight for your word. And I know that sometimes it hits us right between the eyes. But that's where it needs to be. That's what it needs to do. It needs to hit our heart. God, and I pray, Lord, tonight that you would work in our lives and that you would continue to draw us close. And Lord, that we would see your word as love, as protection, as what it is for us. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the protection that it gives. And God, I pray right now for the household, every household represented tonight, God, that we would take seriously the call to clean our house out, to make it a place of unworldliness but of godliness, that we would be able to train our children, or that whoever comes over to our house would see, as for me and my house, we serve the Lord. God, help us, because it's hard for our flesh to submit. I think of that verse that Jesus said, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. And you know us so well. But your heart is for us. Your spirit is with us. We have your word. God, help us to walk in it. Like we learned tonight, help us to wash in the water of the word and to know that we've already been washed in the blood of Jesus for our sanctification. Help us to be busy about your business, we ask. Be with us in Jesus' name. God, we just pray that that song would ring true in our lives, that we'd surrender to you and we'd allow you, God, to work in us. And God, I just pray also that if there's anyone here tonight that, as we go through this section, says, I've done that, these things that are guilty and these things that are, according to God's word, worthy of death. And I pray, God, that you'd reveal to them that your grace and your blood is more powerful than any sin. If we will repent, if we will turn from it and walk towards you and turn to your ways. And I thank you for that, God. I thank you for the power of your blood and your forgiveness, that you said those sins are no longer remembered. What a mighty, awesome God. What a beautiful Savior we have. Lord, we thank you for that. So go out tonight in the peace of our Savior and walk with him. Amen. God bless you guys.